Hi, I'm Laurence Clement, and I'm Program Director of Academic Career Development at the University of California, San Francisco in the Office of Career and Professional Development. This video is part of a series called the Strategic Postdoc, and this is Module 1, Position Yourself for a Postdoc. And today, in this video, we're going to talk about building a game plan and really backward designing your postdoctoral training strategy to meet your career goals. In the last video, we talked about reframing your postdoc as a training and kind of made a comparison with soccer and professional soccer. And we talked about the fact that the postdoc is a training that prepares for a career. And the big important question to ask yourself when you're really considering your postdoc training strategy is to ask first, will your postdoctoral experience provide you with the training you need? The second piece is that postdoc ends with a competition for a position. And the question is, what does it take to be competitive for this position? And what do you need to demonstrate? The third thing we talked about is that you need to see the goal to get a shot. And really specifically, you need to think about what you're going to need to learn during your postdoc. And that's going to amount to your training objectives. This is the reason why you're in a postdoc, to learn these things. So think about what your training objectives are going to be. And I'm going to give you a few examples in the next few slides. We're also talking about the fact that it requires a coach and a strategy. And so you're going to have to think about what strategy you need to put in place to succeed and who might be the right mentor to support that strategy. And not every mentor is the right person for every strategy. So if we put these things together, when you backward design your training, you basically start with what it takes to be competitive, which are your qualifications. What are the qualifications for the position that you're targeting? And then you backward design to think about what you need to learn during your postdoc, which are your training objectives. And then think about from that, what strategy you need to put in place to succeed. And that's your training strategy, right? And so I'm going to show you two examples of a backward design plan for two people who we actually talked about in the last video, who are examples of two types of people we meet in our advising role at UCSF. Lily is applying for research intensive faculty positions, while Carlos is looking at other options. And so when we look at the types of postdocs in academia, Lily is going to be trying to do something that's more like a research intensive faculty postdoc, while Carlos is going to be trying to do a research and teaching faculty postdoc, but also trying to prepare maybe for an industry scientist position. So if we think about the qualifications that Lily and Carlos need for their next position, and let's start with Lily, we actually do know what qualifications are required. Lily needs to have publications, and you all know that you need publications to get a faculty position at a research-intensive institution. But what you also really need to know is that these publications need to be quite regular throughout your graduate and postdoctoral training, and they need to be pretty impactful, and they need to also demonstrate productivity, like a lot of productivity throughout your postdoc. You also will need to develop a research program that's fundable by an R1 grant. And what's really interesting is that a lot of graduate students and postdocs actually don't really realize how important that is in the hiring process. And to be fundable by an R1 grant, this means that you're going to have to propose something that's really ambitious and impactful to the hiring committee at the end of your postdoc. And you're also going to have to present something that's long-term. So you're going to have a long-term vision and strategy that's exciting and that seems feasible. You're going to have to really demonstrate that you know how to do this project. And then it needs to be independent from your PI, because you don't want to be competing with your PI for R1 grants, and the hiring committees are really aware of that. So the independence is going to be very important. And then finally, you're going to have stellar and specific recommendations from your graduate advisor, from your postdoc PI, and also from other mentors, better if they're well-known or if they're well-respected in the field. But those recommendations need to be really specific, and these people need to really be able to talk about how much of a leader you're able to be in the field in the future. So how do we know this? Well, we have a tool called the Academic Career Readiness Assessment, which we developed through a study of faculty around the country. And this tool is available on the UCSF website, and it's free for all. And there's also a research paper about this that describes the methodology and gives a lot more detail about how faculty make decisions when they're hiring. So I really recommend that you check out the paper as well. So Lily is going to basically have to look at those qualifications and think about the things she needs to learn throughout her training to reach that goal. And so some of the things that she might need to learn, I've listed here. And examples are things like designing and conducting a high-impact research project, writing competitive grant proposals, identifying fundable research ideas, also explaining clearly what the big picture of her research project is so she can convince her audience that she has a really exciting project and a long-term vision. She's also going to have to identify a research niche that is her own, that is unique, to be in less competition with other researchers in the field. And finally, she might need to learn to develop these relationships with other mentors than her PI and her graduate advisor. So these mentors can actually provide not only stellar, but specific letters of recommendation. And I find working with graduate students and postdocs, that's a really tough one. A lot of them are not encouraged to actually go outside of the lab and talk to other faculty. And this is one of the hardest things for them to learn. So it is something that needs to be learned. Now, for Carlos, the qualifications he's going to need if he's interested in a research and teaching focused faculty position at a primarily undergraduate institution, these qualifications can vary, but we're going to use an example where he's actually applying to positions that are very teaching focused, where there's a lot more teaching than research in the expectations for these faculty. And so he's going to have really to meet qualifications that are very different from Lily. Carlos will need to demonstrate that he has experience applying evidence-based practices in his teaching, especially with a student population that is similar to the institution he's going to apply for. So if he's not at a similar institution, and most likely he isn't, he's going to have to go and get that teaching experience during his postdoc if he hasn't gotten it during his PhD. He's also going to need to have experience using, addressing issues of racial justice and social justice and equity, both in the classroom and in the lab, especially if he goes to a primarily undergraduate institution that is has a very diverse student population. And then he's also going to have a research plan that is really tailored to the student population and the level of the students who will be working with him, and then to the limited resources of the department. And that might make some changes from what he's doing as a postdoc, because we see a lot of postdocs that are using really large machinery and or really large equipment or very expensive equipment that these institutions do not have, or are using model organisms that cannot be housed in those institutions. So that means some reframing, and that reframing can happen towards the end of his postdoc, but it's even better if he starts his postdoc with that new research program. And at least he needs to make sure he has the skills to handle these organisms or to do the research with other type of equipment. And then he's going to have to show that he's enthusiastic about working at an undergraduate institution. It can't be his backup plan. And he's going to have to fit with the discipline of the department and make sure that his discipline is not already represented in the department, and that he can also teach all the disciplines that you need him to teach. And then last, he might need some papers, less at a more teaching-focused RT institution, research and teaching institution, but he might still need a few papers, and so he'll still have to think about his productivity in terms of research. He just might not need highly impactful papers, and so that looks different for the PI as well. Is the PI willing to publish lower impact papers when Carlos joins the lab? So if we think about this, Carlos will need to think about what he needs to learn, and he'll need to learn things that are very different from Lily. He'll need to design a curriculum using evidence-based practices. At UCSF, we have a course called Step Up, which is teaching evidence-based practices. These courses exist across the country. And in our course, we help trainees learn to develop a curriculum using these practices. So he will have to engage in a type of course like this. He will also have to learn about inclusive teaching and mentoring practices, and that also will require training. As I said, design a feasible research program with limited resources. He'll also have to demonstrate he can work collaboratively in the classroom and in the lab, so there'll be much more focus on we, on the work we did, than on I, whereas Lily will have to talk about her contribution to the work of the team. She'll be very careful about saying when it's her work versus it's somebody else's work or it's collaborative work. And then he'll have to learn to design and conduct some research projects independently, but not at the scale that Lily will have to do with a very large research program. And so the last thing I'll leave you with is that really there are three main strategies to consider when developing your IDP. And if you kind of deploy this across the different types of postdoc positions you can be engaged in, it can look really different. And this is what the information you need to actually find the right postdoc position for yourself, which is for a research intensive faculty postdoc, you're going to need to engage in a high level of training in the lab and learn a lot of skills in the lab in a very intensive way. But you're going to spend a lot less time on your career development strategy. Whereas in a career exploration postdoc, you're going to need to actually spend a lot of time in the career development, which is spent outside the lab. And so you need to find a PI that is okay with you doing that work outside the lab. And that's also the case for a research and teaching faculty postdoc, where you're going to have to spend some time outside the lab learning to teach and teach. And that should be also something that's okay with the PI, and that's even supported by the PI. So I'll let you think about all the different dimensions of the different strategies that you need to consider when developing your IDP in the future. And I want to thank you for watching this video. We'll see you in the next video.